This
topic is about
conference will now be recorded.
Appendicitis, the most common surgical case which is encountered by a general surgeon or anything about surgery. So appendicitis is the bread and butter of a practicing general surgeon. So it is most common surgical emergency, which is ideally encountered in a emergency situations. So going into detail, so we'll discuss this topic in different subheadings, that is history, anatomy, the pathophysiology, clinical features and investigations of acute appendicitis. Then comes the differential diagnosis of acute appendicitis and the surgical component of the surgery, that is appendicectomy, which are two types, open appendicectomy and laparoscopic appendicectomy. So coming to history, Leonardo da Vinci is the first one who depicted the appendix in anatomical drawings. Claudius Amion was the first one who has done the successful appendicectomy in 1735. And Kurt Seven was the first one who did the laparoscopic appendicectomy in 1980. He is a gynecologist who has done a first laparoscopic appendicectomy. So laparoscopy as an advent was first used by a gynecologist. Then it progressed into other specialties like surgery, urology, etc. So coming to anatomy, appendix is situated two-thirds posterior lateral to the cecum. It is situated in the between the cecum and the ileocecal junction. So there are various positions of appendix: subcecal, paracecal, retrocecal, pelvic, etc. These are the most common ones. There are uncommon varieties like preileal and posterior, etc. Retrocecal is the most common position. About 74% of the appendix are situated in retrocecal. As the name indicates, it is posterior to the cecal. Cecum. Most commonly, appendix is situated posterior to the cecum. So pelvic is the second most common, that is 21%. And rest constitute very negligent amount, that is preileal, posterior, and paracecal. So there is an entity called a situs inversus visarium, which is appendix in left iliac fossa. So appendix is ideally situated in the right iliac fossa, but in conditions like situs inversus visarium, appendix is situated in the left iliac fossa. This is due to the developmental defect where the entire elementary tract is in reverse position. Coming to size and location, an average appendix size is about 11 centimeters. It can vary from 2 to 20 centimeters, but ideally it is about 11 to 12 centimeters. So the diameter of the appendix is usually 6 to, here it is given as 7 to 8, but it is ideally a 6 mm in diameter. That is the center, the lumen and diameter is about 6 mm. Whenever an appendix lumen is more than 8 mm, you suspect it as an appendicitis on an ultrasound. Whenever your patient comes to your OPD with a complaint of pain in right iliac fossa, to screen him for appendicitis. So during the investigation procedure, an ultrasound is done. On ultrasound, when the lumen of the appendix is more than 8 mm, you suspect it to be an appendicitis. You can't be sure, because it is just 8 mm, you can't be sure that it is appendicitis, but you can suspect it as an appendicitis. There are other factors which lead you to the diagnosis of appendicitis. called as Alvarado scoring system, which is very important. And you should know that by heart. I will discuss it in the next slides. So the record of the record appendix is measured 26 centimeters in Safranco August, Zagreb, which is in Croatia, on August 2006. This is the longest appendix ever discovered. So coming to anatomy, it is posterior medial wall of the cecum, 2 centimeters below the ileocecal orifice. And appendix contains the appendicular orifice, which is a seminular fold of mucous membrane. It is also known as valve of Gerlach. So what this valve of Gerlach does is, it obliterates the lumen of the appendix from foot entering into it. Appendix is a rudimentary organ or structure. If you can call it a structure, it is rudimentary structure, which is of no use historically, but in recent studies it is said that it has it produces the lymphoid factors or lymphocyte factors, etc. So it is still in a discussion. So whenever food enter into the food or fecalate or anything into the appendix, it is a blind ending structure. So it, whenever anything goes into it, it cannot come outside of it, which leads to obstruction of the valve and bacterial fermentation within the blind ending structure, which leads to appendicitis. So this valve of Gerlach prevents that from happening. And appendix contains a mesoappendix, which is a peritoneum layer. Within it contains the appendicular artery. So appendicular artery is a lower division of the ileocolic artery. So this is the ileocolic artery from which appendicular artery is derived. There are in certain patients there can be accessory appendicular arteries. In the accessory appendicular artery is called as artery of Seshachalam. It was named after an Indian surgeon as artery of Seshachalam. You should remember that. So people, some examiners might ask you in the Viva about accessory appendicular artery. So whenever thrombosis occur to the artery, it can lead to gangrenous appendicitis. It is very grievous form of appendicitis. Coming to venous drainage, it is through appendicular vein and ileocolic vein, which again drain into the superior mesenteric vein, which drain into the portal vein. So the nerve supply is sympathetic nerves derived from T9 to T10. These are also known as celiac plexus. The parasympathetic is through the vagus. So the lymphatic and Kleczynski cells are 8 to 15 lymphatic vessels are present in the mesoappendix. Drain into the ileocolic node, and ileocolic nodes again drain into the superior mesenteric nodes, and superior mesenteric nodes again drain into the celiac nodes. So this is the lymphatic supply, lymphatic drainage of the appendix. Again, in the crypts of the appendicular lumen contains the argentaffin cells. So which through this argentaffin cells, carcinoid tumors might develop. So carcinoid tumors is a different entity altogether, which surgery people might be discussing with you in your final semesters, that is 8th or 9th semesters. So there are different types of development anomalies in appendix, which are classified into wall bridge anomaly A, B, and C. So what is a wall bridge anomaly? So in type A anomaly, there are different types called type A, type B1, B2, and type C. In type A anomaly, there is a single cecum and duplicate and partial duplication of appendix with single base. Coming to the picture before, the A shows the wall bridge anomaly A with partial duplication of the appendix. Coming to type B1, there are two separate appendices arising from the single cecum. So in B, you can see there are two appendices coming from the cecum, the single cecum. This is the ileum, and this one and this one are the appendix. In B2, there is something called as stenia coli, which is a band of peritoneum on the cecum. From this arises the appendix. This is B2 type of wall bridge anomaly. And coming to C, there are double cecum, each with its own appendix. So these are various types of anomalies present. So for historical perspective and theoretical purpose, we should remember this wall bridge anomaly. So what are the predisposing factors for appendicitis? Appendicitis is usually present in early age group of patients. That is in early 20s to 30s. Regarding the socioeconomic condition, it is peculiarly in high profile. That is, who takes low fiber food, fast foods, and all. So, and the lymphoid hyperplasia of the appendix is another predisposing factor, as it is a lymphoid tissue. Whenever the epithelium get hyperplasia, it turns into hyperplasia, it can lead to appendicitis. So there are different types of causes. These are predisposing factors. Predisposing factors are different to causes. So what are the causes? There are obstructive causes. Example, fecalate. So whenever a food particle occludes the lumen of the appendix, as I discussed earlier, bacterial fermentation occurs and inflammatory reaction takes place in the obliterated lumen. So this leads to appendicitis. And the second one is the bacterial proliferation, that is most commonly through E. coli. And intestinal parasites like pinworm, where it can obliterate the lumen exactly the same way as epicolith and leads to appendicitis. So the other one is the tumors of the cecum, which is very rare and is most commonly seen in older age group, above 50 or above 60 BC. So what is the composition of the fecalith? It's nothing but bacteria, calcium phosphate, epithelial derby of the intestines, fecal material, and foreign bodies rarely. Some young children have the tendency to ingest foreign bodies. So that might lodge near the appendicular lumen or the wall, which can lead to appendicitis. So coming to pathology, there are obstructive and non-obstructive causes. Obstructive causes, these are acute appendicitis, gangrenous appendicitis, parasitical abscess, mucosal of appendix, ruptured appendix, etc. might lead to due to obstructive appendicitis. These are all the aftermaths of the pathology. So this is the sequence in which it is occurs. So when the appendicitis is when the patient has appendicitis, when you do not intervene, what happens is it turns into gangrenous appendicitis, because there is a layman term in which పీపుల్ డిస్క్రైబ్ అపెండిక్స్ 24 గంటల నొప్పి అని. సో వాట్ ఈస్ దిస్ 24 గంటల నొప్పి మీన్స్ యూ షుడ్ ఇంటర్వీన్ విత్ ఇన్ 24 అవర్స్ ఆఫ్ ద పెయిన్. అదర్వైజ్ వాట్ హ్యాపన్స్ ఇస్ దీస్ ఆర్ ద సీక్వెన్స్ ఆఫ్ ఈవెంట్స్ దట్ హ్యాపన్స్ వెన్ యూ డూ నాట్ ఇంటర్వీన్ విత్ ఇన్ 24 అవర్స్ ఆఫ్ అపెండిసైటిస్. దట్ ఈస్ గ్యాంగ్రీనస్ దెన్ ఇట్ లీడ్స్ టు గ్యాంగ్రీనస్ అపెండిసైటిస్. When gangrene occurs due to the inflammatory reactions which occur on the wall of the appendix, it leads to abscess formation or a mass. What is an appendicular mass is the inflammatory appendix adhere to the surrounding bowel, cecum, small bowel, large bowel, everything gets attached and forms a small mass. So that mass, during the appendicular mass, surgery is contraindicated, because whenever you do surgery on an appendicular mass, what happens is you can perforate the surrounding bowels. As the tissue gets friable, everything, every structure is very flimsy. So whenever you try to separate the surrounding bowel with the appendix, there are chances of iatrogenic bowel injuries. So to prevent it, whenever an appendix is more than 24 or more than 48 hours, you should ideally should not operate. But it changes to from person to person. That is why an expert in opinion from general surgeon is paramount. So what happens after the appendicular mass is, it turns into a mucosal of appendix. That is, inside, as it is a lymphoid tissue, mucus secretion occurs within the cavity of the appendix, within the lumen of the appendix. As the pressure increases, it leads to rupture of the appendix. So whenever the appendix is ruptured, it becomes from a local inflammation to entire abdominal inflammation, because within the appendix, as it is being ruptured, within it contains various amounts of micro bacteria, inflammatory cytokines, etc. Those gets ruptured and spread all over the peritoneum and the rest of the bowel, so it leads to peritonitis. So in the ruptured appendix, again it is an emergency situation, so emergency laparotomy should be done. Whereas in appendicitis, it is only a 3 to 4 centimeters incision on the right iliac fossa on the McBurney point, and you do the surgery. But when it is in ruptured appendix, you don't know the spread of the inflammation. So midline laparotomy is done and appendix is appendicectomy is done. So whatever I have said in the earlier session, that is the same thing here. So the mucus plus inflammatory exudate increases the intraluminal pressure. So this leads to obstructing the lymphatic drainage of the appendix. So this series of cascade of events happen whenever an appendicitis is whenever the patient has an appendicitis. So due to this obstructing lymphatic drainage leads to edema and ulceration, again which leads to bacterial translocation to the submucosa. As the pressure increases, venous obstruction occur. Whenever venous obstruction occur, again further distension of the appendicular lumen is seen, which leads to ischemia. Because whenever there is an overtly distended tissue, blood cannot pass into the capillary level. So this leads to ischemia, bacterial invasion, and acute appendicitis. So what is the clinical dictum of an acute appendicitis patient is fever and WBC more than 18,000. These are one of the laboratory investigations what you do to rule out to suspect appendicitis. Whenever the patient comes to your OPD with a right iliac fossa pain and fever, vomitings, you go and do a specific tests that are WBC counts and ultrasonography and chest X-ray. So what chest X-ray does is it shows a air under diaphragm in a perforated appendix to rule out whether it is a perforated or non-perforated appendix. So chest X-ray gives you a clearer picture, and ultrasound clearly shows you the inflammatory sign. So that is fat stranding, luminal increase of luminal diameter, as I have discussed in the first slide. More than 8 mm of diameter, you can suspect it is an appendicitis. So this is how a gangrenous appendix will look. Usually it is very small when it is normal, but in gangrenous appendix there is color change and all the gangrenous changes are seen. So this is everything I said in the earlier lecture about the appendicular mass. So this is the mucosal when it is distended above its normal. This is how an appendix looks. So next stage is perforation. So in this patient, before it is being perforated, the surgeon has operated and taken the mucosal. So if it is left like that, the next stage would be perforated appendix. So what are the clinical features? The main distinctive feature is pain, which is in the right iliac fossa. Then comes the anorexia, vomiting, other inflammatory, any inflammatory condition will have these symptoms, that is anorexia and vomiting. You can also have vomiting in renal colic. Whenever a patient has a rain, due to the spasmodic effects, vomitings and anorexia is seen in even them. So it is one of the differential diagnosis for right iliac fossa pain is renal stone. So these are the various clinical signs you see, that is rise in temperature, tenderness in right iliac fossa. Patient guards his muscles, abdominal muscles, whenever you try to elicit his abdomen. So there is a voluntary guarding. There is a guarding of the abdomen. Then comes the rebound tenderness, which is called as Blumberg sign. So what is rebound tenderness is? Whenever you palpate the patient's abdomen, when you are removing your finger, there is a sharp pain elicited by the patient. This is due to the stretch of the peritoneum. This is called as rebound tenderness. And foul breath is a very complicated sign, because if the patient is having a foul breath, you can always suspect it as a perforated appendix. So the features of the perforated appendix are the tachycardia, gangrene and peritonitis. So in rebound tenderness is also seen in peritonitis. So there are various signs which you use in the clinical OPD, in the surgical OPD, to suspect a case of appendicitis. That is pointing sign. So whenever a patient comes with a right iliac fossa pain, you should ask the patient to point his area of pain. So in appendicitis, the patient will directly show you where it is hurting him the most. That is in the right iliac fossa between the umbilicus and the anterior superior iliac spine. That is called a McBurney point. So that is one indication that it might be an appendicitis. Then comes the Rossig sign. In delayed, that is after 6 hours or something, since the patient has pain, there is shift of pain from right to left. Patient elicits left iliac fossa pain. So what is Rossig sign is, whenever a clinician palpates his left iliac fossa, the pain is transmitted to the right iliac fossa, and he feels pain in the right iliac fossa while palpating the left iliac fossa. That is Rossig sign. And psoas sign, This is to elicit, as in the first slides I have already discussed about the positions of the appendix that are retrocecal and pelvic, etc. So psoas sign is to differentiate whether the pelvis, whether the appendix is in retrocecal or in the pelvis. So this what happens is when the patient hyperextends his knee, he feels pain. That indicates the appendix in retrocecal position. Obturator sign is also the similar to elicit the position of the appendix. Then comes the Dumfries sign. So whenever the patient cough, he feels pain in the right iliac fossa. Dumphy and all are not important. The main important ones are the Rosic sign, obturator sign, psoas sign, pointing sign, etc. Then this is the hyperesthesia of Schirrin. So this is a triangle drawn between umbilicus, pubic tubercle. This is the umbilicus, this is pubic tubercle, this is the anterior superior iliac spine. So an imaginary triangle. So within this, if the patient within this triangle, if a patient complains of pain, you should always suspect it to be an appendicitis. So remember this, hyperesthesia and Schirrin's triangle. So what is hyperesthesia is tingling sensation on the within these borders can lead you to diagnosis of appendicitis. When his point tenderness is umbilicus to right iliac fossa, pain between the that is the McBurney point tenderness. So investigations are total leukocyte count is ordered. So when the neutrophil count of the differential cells is more than 75%, you can suspect it to be an inflammatory type. You cannot say due to the presence of neutrophils that this is an appendicitis. Any itis, any inflammatory condition can have neutrophils more than 75%. So as I discussed earlier, abdominal X-ray, ultrasound, and CT in adults patients, and this is the newest technology which we are using to diagnose any disease. So CT is a must these days. And again, pregnancy test is a must in early in young girls, because pregnancy can also, ectopic pregnancy can also cause this right iliac fossa pain. So to rule out that, pregnancy test is a must in females in reproductive age group. So then comes the Alvarado scoring. If anyone has a paper or something, just write it down. Of the entire topic, this is very the most important one. If you don't even remember the rest, you should remember the Alvarado scoring. So there is a scoring system to diagnose acute appendicitis. So what is the Alvarado scoring is? This is migratory right iliac fossa pain has a score of 1. Anorexia has a score of 1. Nausea and vomiting has a score of 1. So then those are the symptoms. Then comes the sign. That are tenderness in right iliac fossa has 2. Rebound tenderness has 1. Elevated temperature has 1. Then comes the laboratory finding. That is leukocytosis. As I said in the previous slide, more than 75%. If the leukocyte counts are more than 75%, you give the score as 2. The shift to left of the neutrophils is 1. So the entire score is of 10. So of these, the score is more than 7 to more than 7. It is predictive of appendicitis. And now the score is 5 to 6. You should further test the patient with CT and ultrasound to come to a diagnosis. So when it is a 1 to 4, you should look for other causes that comes in the differential diagnosis. You can rule out appendicitis. So this is Alvarado scoring. I'll stay here for 1 minute. If anyone wants to write it down, write it down. So moving on. So coming to the treatment of acute appendicitis. So the first thing you should always do is nilpar oral. So that is nilpar mouth. You advise the patient to not drink or eat anything until you say so. So then you admit the patient and keep him on IV fluid supplements. Then analgesics should always be delayed until you go through the investigations, because you cannot elicit the right iliac for the pain or tenderness or any signs of peritonitis, etc., if you give the patient analgesic within the first minute he comes into your OPD. So whenever you're suspecting appendicitis, you should always delay the analgesics until the investigations are done. That is not given in any textbook or anything. That is what we practice in general practice whenever we treat an appendicitis patient. So then comes the antibiotics. These are older regimen, the ofloxacin or ornithazole. So what we actually do is keep him on higher third generation cephalosporins and a gram negative coverage with metronidazole antibiotics. So and the 100% cure is appendicectomy within 24 hours as soon as possible. So that is the protocol which we follow. So what are the indications of appendicectomy or acute appendicitis, recurrent appendicitis? So there is a thing called as recurrent appendicitis. So this occurs in patients who don't go for surgery. So a patient comes to your OPD with appendicitis. You advise him for appendicectomy due to fear or things like that. What they do is they take medication, that is painkillers and antibiotics. With the painkillers and antibiotics, the inflammatory reaction subsides, but the cause and the cause is not gone. So what happens is in another 1 or 2 months, again he comes with appendicitis to your OPD. So there are patients who do this for years together. They just take this analgesics and antibiotics and live through the pain out of the fear for surgery. So if you have to be rid of that, you should always go for appendicectomy. Then comes the mucosal of appendix and carcinoma. These are the indications for appendicectomy. Coming to incisions, there are different incisions. Gridiron or lance incision. Lance incision is commonly used incision in open appendicectomy. Bikini incision is for cosmetic purpose. It is a slightly lower in the. It is done in the bikini line. The most commonly used incisions are lance incision and McBurney's incision. So these are the various types of incisions. So this is the McBurney point. Here it is. This incision is known as gridiron incision. This is the lance incision. Lance incision have a better cosmetic result. Scar can be negligible when compared to gridiron incision. And regarding the surgery, I will take the next class in which I will show you the open surgery and laparoscopic surgery, how the event of things we do in the surgery, from skin incision to the appendicectomy to the again skin closure. I'll show both the open appendicectomy and laparoscopic appendicectomy. So to be brief, after opening the muscle and aponeurosis, the muscle, there are two types of techniques they use. Most commonly we use the muscle. Some surgeons, old surgeons, that do the muscle cutting type of surgery. So what happens in muscles cutting is it is very painful in post-operative period. So in your technique is muscle splitting. Just split the muscle from your field of operation instead of cutting it. So once you are into the peritoneal cavity, you identify the tenia coli and reach to the appendix. Once the appendix is identified, tip is held with the tissue holding forces. And this thing is called as the mesoappendix, this yellow thing. Behind the appendix is mesoappendix. Within that consists the appendicular artery. So appendicular artery is ligated and mesoappendix is cut. So you can clearly see the appendicular artery here. So a rent is created here and appendicular artery is ligated and appendix is taken out. So again, when the base of the appendix is ligated, and again this there is a thing called as post-string suturing of the stump. To invaginate the stump into the cecum, post-string suture is applied on the stump. So the stump goes in. So this is the post-string suture. So once it is applied and tightened, so the stump goes inside, which reduces the chance of there is a post-operative complication called as stump appendicitis. So some people, about 1% of the patients who undergo appendectomy operation, presents with stump appendicitis. So whatever the stump that is remaining, again leads to similar pain and inflammation and condition similar to appendicitis. So that is called a stump appendicitis. To prevent that, stump is invaginated, but is rarely practiced now, because in endoscopic surgery, no one is going to apply a post-string suture on the stump. Very negligible amount of cases are seen with the stump appendicitis. So that's how it looks when the stump is buried. So regarding the surgery, in detail, I'll discuss in the next class. So there are special situations, because every appendix is not the same appendix. There are different challenges that you face in the operating theater, where sometimes the appendix stump might be, the appendicular base might be necrosed, so which leads to inflammation with carrying on into the cecal wall. So in those situations, you will never do a posting suture, because if you apply a posting on the cecal wall, which is edematous and inflamed, what happens is it will cut through the edematous tissue. So that leads to, again, dreaded post-operative complications like fecal fistula. So there is a repeated fecal contamination and fecal feces coming outside from the cecal wall, from the skin incision, which forms a fecal fistula. It is very dreaded complication. So to avoid those situations, you should never apply a posting suture on an edematous cecal wall. So this is the same thing applies here. On the base of the appendix is inflamed, you should not crush the base. So appendix is ligated close to the cecum, after which it is amputated and stump is being invaginated. So what are the complications of appendicectomy? This is not appendicitis complications. Complications of appendicectomy. So wound infection is the most common one. Intra-abdominal abscess, because you wash the operated area post surgery. So if any fluid or pus is still left intact, it can lead to intra-abdominal abscess. So ileus is most common complication in the first day. TPS is lack of bowel movement. So you cannot hear bowel movements immediately after the surgery. After one day, it normalizes. So open appendectomy nowadays is done in spinal anesthesia. So respiratory complications like pneumonia, etc., common in laparoscopic appendectomy, where you have to give the patient a general anesthesia. DVT and embolism due to lack of mobility postoperatively, these are very rare. And there are protocols for DVT prophylaxis and embolism. You should follow those protocols. And as I have discussed earlier, the fecal fistula, most dreaded one. So always be very sure of your suturing techniques to avoid this. So this is the lump, appendicular lump, which I have discussed earlier. So when appendix gets attached to the surrounding structures, it is almost impossible to differentiate it from other structures because everything is red inside. You cannot differentiate it ideally. So that is why you should never do intervene operatively in an appendicular lump unless it is a perforation. So there is a regimen called Ochsner-Sherin's regimen, which is very important. Again, every examiner, if you have a case of appendicitis, you'll definitely ask the Ochsner-Sherin regimen. So here it is given, appendicular lump, don't operate. Because there are severe adhesion and difficult to separate the part, dangerous to operate, chances of fecal fistula, and chances of iatrogenic injury. So this is the Ochsner-Sherin regimen. Along with Albedo scoring, write this one down. So what happens is, whenever you elicit a lump in the right iliac fossa, first thing you should do is mark the size of the swelling on the patient's skin. With a pen, you mark the size of the swelling. If and further assess it. The next day again, you see the size of the swelling, whether it is increasing or decreasing. Again, mark it. So this gives an idea whether it is increasing without ultrasonic need. So that is one. Then what you do is nail per orum. That is, you should not advise the patient to drink or eat anything. IV fluid, and it is replaced with IV fluids. Antibiotics and analgesics are given. And, temperature, pulse rate, and the fluid input and output chart are maintained 4th hourly. So whenever the mass is getting decreased and the patient's condition is improving, you take a chance and allow the patient liquids. So rest is the symptomatic treatment, that is vomiting. If there is vomiting, you give an antiemetic and PPI. So after 6 to 8 weeks of treatment, so this Ochsner-Sherin regimen is only followed for about 3 to 4 days. Then the patient will become normal, absolutely normal. He can be sent home, and he is advised to come to the surgical OPD after 6 to 8 weeks to undergo interval appendicectomy. So what I have said earlier, if he doesn't undergo appendicectomy, so this episodes happen repeatedly. So that type of appendicectomy is called as interval appendicectomy. So there is about 90% success rate for this regimen. So when the patient does not respond to this regimen and mass, in an appendicular mass or in a right iliac fossa mass, you should suspect it for a Crohn's or a carcinoma. Crohn's disease and carcinoma. Crohn's is an inflammatory bowel disease. Actually, we discussed to you people in the final year of your MBBS. So, So these are the criteria to stop treatment and go for surgery in an appendicular when there is a rising pulse rate, rising temperature, increase in abdominal pain, increase in size of mass, vomiting with the gastric aspirate, etc. This suspects you to a perforated type of appendix. So you should stop the conservative treatment and go for surgery. Coming to differential diagnosis of appendicular lung, the hypertrophic ileocecal tuberculosis is one, and the carcinoma of the cecum can present as an appendicular lung. Crohn's disease can present as an appendicular lung. Actinomycosis, ovarian cyst in female can present as an appendicular lung. Lymphadenitis can give the same picture. So coming to appendicular malignancy, the most common is mucinous adenocarcinoma. That is 38%, adenocarcinoma 26%, carcinoid is 17%. So carcinoid and all not important to you at this stage. They are a separate entity and will be discussed in your final year MBBS. Carcinoids, carcinomas, etc. So coming to differential diagnosis of acute appendicitis in adults, there are different from, this is different for to males and females. So in males, you can differentiate from terminal ileitis, ureteric colic, right sided pyelonephritis, which is infection of the kidney. Perforated peptic ulcer can give you a picture of acute appendicitis. Torsion of testis can give you the same picture. Because the pain is referred into the right iliac fossa and torsion. Acute pancreatitis, etc., can give you a different, similar picture. In females, acute appendicitis can be masked with ruptured ectopic pregnancy, torsion of the ovarian cyst, salpingitis. What is salpingitis? Salpingitis is fallopian tube inflammation. Endometriosis, etc. These are all specific to female, which can give you a similar picture to acute appendicitis. So the take-home message is appendicitis is the most common surgical emergency in 20 to 30 age group. The most commonest cause is fecalin. The commonest features are right iliac fossa, anorexia, increase in temperature, leukocytosis, etc. The treatment is appendicectomy, Oshner-Sarin regimen. You should always remember that for appendicular lump. And after the regimen is followed, 4 to 6 to 8 weeks after the surgery, you should go for interval appendicectomy. So this is appendicitis in brief. In the next class, I will show you the surgical part of the appendicitis, that is open appendicectomy and laparoscopic appendicectomy. So your roll numbers are here. So is these things your roll numbers 32, 104, 64?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, students.